My name is Elia Almquist, and my husband Billy spoke yesterday to the men and sat in on it. And I have the three little blonde girls that are not here. Well, one's bald, but two blonde. And then I have sisters and brothers and my dad here also. You can probably tell which ones they are because they look like me. And we're from Wisconsin. We're kind of not in one spot all the time. But the Monroes asked me to speak on the woman's honorable role. So I'm going to open with prayer and then we'll turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Thank you, Lord, for this time and the opportunity to share with the women here. And thank you for the time of fellowship that we've had so far and the like-mindedness and the encouragement and the challenging, the word that has been brought to us and shared from the different speakers. And please bless our time here together in studying more of your word. Amen. So 1 Corinthians chapter 12. I'm going to start in verse 20. But now are they many members, but yet one body. And the eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need of thee, nor again the head to the feet, I have no need of you. Nay, much more, those members of the body which seem to be more feeble are necessary. For those members of the body which we think to be less honorable, upon these we bestow more abundant honor, and our comely parts have more abundant comeliness. For our comely parts have no need, but God hath tempered the body together, having given more abundant honor to that part which lacked, that there should be no schism in the body, but that the members should have the same care one for another. And sometimes it might feel like, as women, we have a lesser role than men. We might think, you know, all I'm doing is sweeping the floor and making food and changing diapers or taking care of the elderly or something that might not feel as honorable, if you want to say that, as preaching or leading the family or different things that might seem like bigger, more honorable roles for the men that the men have. But God puts great value on a godly woman's contribution to the body of Christ. And you know, let's look back at verse 23. And those members of the body which we think to be less honorable, upon these we bestow more abundant honor, and our uncomely parts have more abundant comeliness. So no matter how small your service might feel to you, God values it, and it's good service for him. Let's turn to 1 Peter 3:7. Likewise, ye husbands, dwell with them according to knowledge, giving honor unto the wife as the weaker vessel, and as being heirs together of the grace of life, that your prayers be not hindered. And also Proverbs 15:33. Instruction of wisdom, and before honor is humility. That's one thing to keep in mind when you're thinking about the honorable role that women have, is that humility comes first, and most importantly, the fear of the Lord. That we need to be doing what we do for the Lord, not for ourselves or pride or any of those types of motivators. Let's look at some of the things that God designed women specifically to fill the role of. We know that Eve was sent to be a help, meet for her husband. And let's go to 1 Corinthians 7, verse 34. And it tells us what a married woman's primary role is, and what is unmarried woman's primary role is. Chapter 7 there has a lot of good information on marriage and being married or unmarried. But in 34, it talks specifically about that there's a difference also between a wife and a virgin. The unmarried woman careth for the things of the Lord, that she may be holy both in body and in spirit. But she that is married careth for the things of the world, how she may please her husband. So when you're still unmarried, or you've been married and are now unmarried, you have times that you can serve God in a different way than you can when you have a husband, when you have children. Your focus can be different. You have more of an ability to focus on the things of the Lord. So I want those of you that are unmarried to think about that. Do you care for the things of the Lord, that you may be holy both in body and in spirit? That is a very worthy goal, and it's something that as unmarried women, that should be your focus. Not, I know a lot of times the pressure from the world and friends is get married, have a family, that's the most important thing. But this verse tells us that there's a goal for, a role for unmarried ladies of whatever age that they have. That's not only to be married, although that has its own place too. And it says, you know, with the married woman role, you can do the same thing in being holy and serving the Lord, but the focus is going to be different in that your first job is to please your husband and serve him. So let's take a few moments to look at some examples of women in the church that we know about. There aren't a whole lot of them, but there are a few that is specifically that are specifically mentioned, several of them by name. In the scriptures, Romans 16 has a handful of them. There we see Phoebe, and it says in verse 1 of chapter 16, I commend unto you Phoebe, our sister, which is a servant of the church, which is at Cenchrea, that you receive her in the Lord as becometh saints, and that ye assist her in whatsoever business she hath need of you. For she hath been a succorer of many, and of myself also. And succorer is a word that we don't really use today. So I looked it up in the 1828, and it says that he that affords relief, a helper, a deliverer. And I think that's a really good example of things that women can or should be doing in the church, in the body of Christ, in our church family, is providing relief to those that need it, and just generally succoring them, helping, delivering them when they need help. And then the next one spoken of there is Priscilla, Greek Priscilla and Aquila, which is an example of a married couple and a woman who is married. And it talks more about Priscilla in Acts 18, and 1 Corinthians 16:19, some of the things that it says about Priscilla is that she followed her husband from Italy to Corinth when Caesar kicked all the Jews out. So she was going with her husband, and she was a tent maker with him, so she helped him in his business, and traveled with her husband and with Paul from Corinth to Ephesus. And she was in the synagogue with them in Ephesus, and which is where they met Apollos. And they, Priscilla and Aquila brought him to their house, and they expounded the way of God more perfectly to him. So she was able to help teach on a one-on-one type of basis, or help her husband. I don't know exactly what that looked like, but that was one way that she served God. And it also talks about them as a couple laying down their own nets for Paul's life. And I don't really know what that looks like, but in some way they sacrificed themselves to save Paul. And they also had a church in their house. Those are a few ways of serving the Lord for a woman. Then also in Romans 16, it talks, I think it was in, yeah, down at verse 6. Greet Mary, who bestowed much labor on us. So Paul and the other saints she was serving. Down at verse 12, talks about Tryphena and Tryphosa. So with Tryphena and Tryphosa, who labor in the Lord, so they're serving God also, and doing some form of labor, which, you know, sometimes we don't think we want to work, but it is a good thing. Does anyone have any other thoughts that they would like to share about the women that we read about, or other women in the Bible that might be an example of things that we should be emulating? Timothy 2:9. And we could read all the way through verse 15. But I think I'll just go verse 10 at this point. That's a good passage to study. It's all about women. Anybody? In like manner also, that women adore themselves in modest apparel, with shamefacedness and sobriety, not with braided hair or gold, or pearls or costly array, but which becometh women professing godliness with good works. And I had done a study a few years back on the good works that God expects women to do, and I couldn't find my study anywhere. So I'm like, well, I can just cheat. Go with that. Well, not cheap, but you know, have a few more verses that I had already studied out, and I couldn't find it, so I don't have a very complete list. But the rest of that chapter has a lot of them. Most of the things you can find in Paul's epistles are applicable both to married or unmarried women. There are some that are specific to one or the other, but the majority of things can really go across the board. Let's do a list of some of them. You can look at 1 Timothy 5:10, which talks about widows. Well, let's start in verse 9. Let not a widow be taken into the number under 80 years old, having been the wife of one man, well reported of for good works. And here's an example of a few of those good works that they would be reported. If she have brought up children, if she have had lodged strangers, if she have washed the feet, my tongue is not working today. If she have washed the saints' feet, if she have relieved the afflicted, if she have diligently followed every good work. 1 Timothy 2:11. Let the woman learn in silence without subjection. She's not to teach or usurp authority over the man, but to be in silence. And back in chapter 5, one of the things that women are to do is relieve widows. And that's in 1 Timothy 5:16. I don't know if you want to turn to all of these or have me give you the references and tell you what it says. I'm not sure exactly how much time we're supposed to be here. But 1 Corinthians 11 talks about women having long hair for a covering. Let's go to Titus 2:2-5. We're going to start with chapter, verse 2, because in verse 3 it talks about the aged men likewise. And so what it's telling us about the aged men also applies to the aged women. That the aged men be sober, grave, temperate, sound in faith, in charity, in patience. The aged women likewise, that they be in behavior as becometh holiness, not false accusers, not given to much wine, teachers of good things. That they may teach the young women to be sober, to love their husbands, to love their children, to be discreet, chaste, keepers at home, obedient to their own husbands, that the word of God be not blasphemed. And that's a really good list to go through and study that out. Look up different places in the word that those words are used, so you understand the definition of those words. Webster's 1828 has good definitions for those as well. But sometimes we read words and we just kind of like, yeah, that, and that. But if we don't actually study it and find the definition of the words, it can kind of just go in one ear, not the other. At least for me, it helps to have a richer understanding of the words. Let's do 1 Timothy, maybe I did that one right, 2:13? I feel like I did that one right. Another example of good works that a woman is to do is in 1 Timothy 5:5. And again, that's talking about the widows and honoring widows that have done good works throughout their life. And one of the things that it is an example to us that we should be doing is continuing in supplications and prayers night and day. That's in 1 Timothy 5:5. And let's go to Ephesians 5:33. This is one that's specific to married women. Nevertheless, let every one of you in particular so love his wife, even as himself, and the wife see that she reverence her husband. And we can go back up to verse 22 of the same chapter. Wives, submit yourselves unto your own husbands as unto the Lord. There's a similar one in Colossians 3:18. Another one specific to wives is in 1 Timothy 3, verse 11. And this is referring to the wives of a deacon. The wife of a deacon. Even so must their wives be grave, not slanderers, sober, faithful in all things. When we talked about Eve a little bit at the beginning, that she was created as a helpmeet for her husband, I wanted to look at what a godly man is supposed to look like and how we as wives, as daughters, as women that are in connection to brothers, fathers, husbands, how we can help them to be those godly men. Because we have a lot of impact on what they are able to do. And so I want to go through, let's go through a couple passages here. We're going to do two different chapters, 1 Timothy 3 and Titus 1. And they're the qualifications of a bishop, an elder, a deacon. But we all want our men to be godly. So these, even if they're not going to be in that position of leadership, we can still help them to get to those qualifications. So I guess we'll start with 1 Timothy can do that would be helpful or hindering, either one is, we'll look at both of them, both sides of it. This is a true saying, if a man desire the office of a bishop, he desireth a good work. A bishop then must be blameless, the husband of one wife, vigilant, sober, of good behavior, given to hospitality, apt to teach, not given to wine, no striker, not greedy of filthy lucre, but patient, not a brawler, not covetous, one that ruleth well his own house, having his children in subjection with all gravity. For if a man know not how to rule his own house, how shall he take care of the church of God? Not a novice, lest being lifted up with pride, he fall into the condemnation of the devil. Moreover, he must have a report of them which are without, lest he fall into reproach and the snare of the devil. Likewise must the deacons be grave, not double-tongued, not given to much wine, not greedy of filthy lucre, holding the mystery of the faith in a pure conscience. And let these also first be proved, and then let them use the office of a deacon, being found blameless. Even so must their wives be grave, not slanderers, sober, faithful in all things. Let the deacons be the husbands of one wife, ruling their children and their own house as well. For they that have used the office of a deacon well, purchase to themselves a good degree and great boldness in the faith which is in Christ Jesus. And then Titus 1. Verse 5. For this cause I left thee in Crete, that thou shouldest set in order the things that are wanting, and ordain elders in every city, as I had appointed thee. If any be blameless, the husband of one wife, having faithful children, not accused of riot or unruly, a bishop must be blameless as the steward of God, not self-willed, not soon angry, not given to wine, no striker, not given to filthy lucre, but a lover of hospitality, a lover of good men, sober, just, holy, temperate, holding fast the faithful word as he hath been taught, that he may be able, by sound doctrine, both to exhort and to convince the gainsayers. So a lot of those are parallel. So I just made a list of the different traits that are spoken of either in one or both chapters. And so we can start with must be blameless. And anybody can pipe up with what they can think of that a woman, a wife, a daughter could do or not do that could either help or hinder a man in being blameless to the world.
Is this something only with married women?
Nope. What can a woman or wife do to help or hinder her husband or father, for example, to be blameless or to not be blameless? I'll give you an example. If a woman is constantly going around telling everybody, yeah, my husband, he always, leaves his dirty clothes laying on the floor next to bed, he never puts them in the hamper. Even though that's not something that's like a horrible, disqualifying thing, it's going to lower that man in everyone else's estimation. And it's like he's not blameless that as he would have been if you would have kept your mouth shut.
So,
you know?
Also, going to lower the woman.
This is true.
You can admonish him and talk about the good qualities about him. Oh, he works so hard and he does so much for us. I just really appreciate his heart.
Mm-hmm.
And to speak those things out loud of what he does in secret, and honoring mm-hmm. him and his qualities and work ethic.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Anyone else have anything for blameless?
She said she got good qualities and don't gossip.
Next, I have the husband of one wife. I guess as a wife, you can make him not want to have a different wife. vigilant. Ways you could help your husband be vigilant.
read her, it said aged men also, it also said older women. Sober-mindedness applies to everyone.
Right.
And actually, I think it probably applies to women even more than men in some ways. Because I know a lot of women are silly. And I was thinking of that verse, and I can't find it, but the one that talks about they need Catholic silly women laden with sins.
Right.
You know, and so it's a common thing that we have a fault in.
This is true. Yeah, I would think it's easier for a man to be sober if his wife is.
Right.
Of good behavior, I think that would kind of be in the same boat, right, if you're not provoking him to misbehave. He's more likely to be good behavior. How about, this one is pretty easy, given to hospitality or a lover of hospitality. How can a wife or a daughter be helpful in that?
Well, obviously he can't be that way if we don't want people coming over. So it's kind of, you know,
you have to be hospitable too.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Cooking a meal for somebody, offering a meal, opening your home, weekly Bible study, serving in little ways of making cookies.
Yeah, I think most of the time men aren't naturally gifted with being a good host. It takes a hostess. And so, you know, the man might be given to hospitality, but...
He might invite him over, but you got to do the work.
Exactly. Yes, I mean, it just needs that womanly presence to make the home to be invited into, and then to be a good hostess. Definitely think for a man by himself to be hospitable is difficult.
Afterwards, of you make these people come over without telling me.
Yes. Yeah. About a lover of good men. I think another, what you were saying about not gossiping or, you know, pulling someone else down, if you are willing to find the good in other men, humans in general, they're more likely to be able to be a lover of good men. And if you're, every time they say something good about someone, you're like, yeah, well, they do this or that, you know? Constant fault finding will make it more difficult for him. How about apt to teach? Anything that a woman could do to help or hinder a man from being apt to teach?
Pretty soon.
Exactly.
It's also the verse says, be very honest to give an answer. So when they ask you a reason, so if you have a question, not being afraid to go to them, if I don't know this, could you help me with this? Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay. Being willing to be taught yourself by him.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Not given to wine.
Drive your husband to drink. I'm sorry.
No, that's a good point.
But you can also be encouraging as well. You'll see commercials on TV where they have these pretty high-end, I don't know how they explain these type of women. I guess they drink Chardonnay all day, and then they advertise a Chardonnay for these type of women. And so if you're drinking, then you'd probably be invited to certain.
Right, if you're having it in your home, it's going to make it harder for him. I wanted to look at Proverbs, a couple of verses on that. Let's do Proverbs 20, verse 1. If my daughters were too shy, I would have them sing you this one. Chapter 20 of Proverbs, verse 1. Wine is a mocker. Strong drink is raging. And whosoever is deceived thereby is not wise. Another one that's not very often, a book that's not very often used. Go to Habakkuk. Chapter 2, verse 15. Woe unto him that gives giveth his neighbor drink, and putteth thy bottle to him, and makest him drunken also, that thou mayest look on thy nakedness.
Well, that sounds like in your hospitality, you better stick the wine.
Stick with unfermented wine. Grape juice. And then another good verse on this is Proverbs 24:29. Who hath woe? Who hath sorrow? Who hath contentions? Who hath battle? Who hath wounds without cause? Who hath redness of eyes? They that tarry long at the wine, they that go to seek mixed wine, look not thou upon the wine when it is red, when it giveth its color, and the cup when it moveth itself aright. At the last it biteth like a serpent and stingeth like an adder. Thine eyes shall behold strange women. Be another good point there on the husband of one wife. If you're giving your husband wine, you might not be the husband of one wife for very long. And thine heart shall utter perverse things. Yea, thou shalt be as he that lieth down in the midst of the sea, as he that lieth upon the top of a mast. They have stricken me, shalt thou say, and I was not sick. They have beaten me, and I felt it not. When shall I awake? I will seek it yet again. So I'm going to get back to our list. We have no striker. The giveaway that you could help or injure your husband.
Just see if you find a good in him and then do that. And that often is, yeah. And then it'll just be a rewarding cycle instead of a vicious cycle.
Yeah.
And then he won't turn you apart.
Yeah. I think the majority of times that men are strikers, if it's not alcohol related, it's usually wife related. I mean, seriously, it's oftentimes something that we do that's provoking. That gets men upset. They think about it sometimes. We can be kind of annoying creatures.
It's better to sit on the phone with a house hot right than in the house with a contentious
wife. Right. How about not greedy of filthy lucre?
That if we will be content, that will help. That problem, because a lot of times husbands are trying to please us,
yeah,
and that is what causes. I mean, it doesn't always. That's not always the case, obviously.
Right.
But it will help a lot if you're content.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, how many men are trying so hard to get more money because the wife keeps overcharging their credit card at the mall or whatever it is. Constantly asking for more than they're able to provide and
yeah.
Pushing them to it, we can make the problem worse.
She's a very strong personality. He was, and he's my softball coach, so I kind of, and he'll keep coming there and he pick up where somebody else has dropped off. My regular coach has quit, he's the assistant coach.
Mm-hmm.
And he picked it up, he ran the whole team and everything, he just does that stuff. So, and have a strong woman like that and nag at him, he couldn't win. So.
Yeah.
That there's so much power in women's words.
Mm-hmm.
Speak life or death.
Mm-hmm. How about patience? Guess we can give him plenty of practice, right?
I feel I should work with patience.
temperate, I think that's going to go along with the sober and along with the not greedy or filthy lucre. Because if you're not temperate yourself and you're wanting more things or whatever, it's going to be harder for him to be temperate. How about not a brawler? I probably should have gone and done all the definitions of these two. I figured we'd be here all day.
What's the difference between a brawler and a striker? You know, this
thing. I think you could brawl without striking, couldn't you? Mm-hmm. Just arguing and fighting verbally?
Yeah, that could be.
Sure, if a person can brawl by themselves or if they have to have someone to brawl with.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, there's some up there.
We have not covetous. I think that we said about the greedy and filthy lucre could be the same. Mm-hmm. You know, if you have a covetous wife, it's going to be harder for the husband to be content. So you can be content as a wife or a daughter. I'm going to assume when I'm saying wife, most of these are going to be equally applicable to any of the women in his life. But obviously the wife is going to be the most closely associated. So.
More.
Yeah. Yeah, a little more.
But we do have daughters that, you know, try to get their daddies to buy them everything. You know, none of that ever worked for my husband.
Yeah, I mean, I really think all of these, pretty much any woman that's in his family could help or hinder. So it's, I think it's applicable to everyone.
As Paul says, whatsoever state you're in, worth be content. So if you follow that,
yes. Mm-hmm. How about ruleth well his own house? Especially a wife can completely disqualify a husband from being an elder. He can totally ruin it for him. Having his children in subjection with all gravity. Gotten the wrong. 16:44. Behold, everyone that useth Proverbs shall use this proverb against thee, saying, as is the mother, so is the daughter.
Oh.
So, like you said, if you're not submissive to your husband, your children are not going to be. And how you treat your husband is most likely how your daughter's going to treat him, and how your daughter's going to treat your future husband as well.
Because of the flesh, it doesn't always follow. You can have whatever flesh.
Right.
But
as far
we
as
are to do our part.
Right. Yes. Yeah. Well, I think that's a good thing for men to think when they're looking for a wife to look at the mom. And you know, like you said, it's not always, not everything carries over, but it is a good idea. You get an idea of what what she may be. And in 1 Timothy 1:5. It's a good verse anyway. Now the end of the commandment is charity out of a pure heart and of good conscience and of faith unfeigned. I'm not sure exactly what that had to do with it, but either or, yes. 2 Timothy 1:5, is that what I'm looking for? Yes, thank you. When I call to remembrance the unfeigned faith that is in thee, which is Timothy, which dwelt first in thy grandmother Lois and thy mother Eunice, and I am persuaded that in thee also. So there we see 3 generations of teaching of the word, even when the father wasn't present or wasn't necessarily as involved as he should have been. All right, we have 3 more points in those verses left. You must have a good report of them which are without, which I think this kind of goes back to the blameless that we talked about before. Whether anybody has any other input on having a good report of them that are without.
Well, you can help that by what you, like you said earlier, kind of the same kind of thing. Not complaining about your husband, things like that.
What report they hear from you?
It's very good if you have some problems with your husband. The best thing to do is talk to your husband in a proper way, because he's the only one who can change it anyway. And the only thing you're going to, and especially if you complain to your women friends, that is definitely bad for your marriage. And then an even worse thing is to complain to another man.
Yeah, that's for sure.
Or
if
you complain to the wrong group of women.
Yeah.
And they'll taint your mind even.
And then even, so that we don't get caught up in all the just married women things. It could be the same thing with your father also,
right.
young women. You know, you need to respect your fathers and not talk bad about your fathers or complain about your fathers to other people.
And even other men in the church.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you are going to be constantly pulling them down and finding fault with them and telling everybody all the bad things you can think of, it's not going to be helpful to them.
It's difficult to recover from that.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's even true in the secular world. Just take like the workplace, for example.
Mm-hmm.
Your reputation is tarnished. All you can do is leave.
Mm-hmm.
Most people aren't willing to watch and see what
I've got a good example of that, like the Supreme Court thing. Mm-hmm. Whether or not what the woman said was true or not, the man's reputation is tarnished.
Mm-hmm.
So we need to be very careful in what we say and make sure what we say is true.
Yes. Last one I have on this list is not double-tongued. First of all, can anybody give just a approximate definition of what double-tongued might mean?
Well, I could say one thing to you and then say something completely different.
Fork tongue. Yeah. You speak with fork tongue.
Right? Yeah, right. Something
the white man is known for.
Any ideas how we could help or hinder in that regard?
Well, obviously we shouldn't do that. We should be honest, straightforward in our dealings with people. Mm-hmm. not say one thing to one person and something else.
Yeah. And I think it's interesting because at the end of this, it says, even so, must their wives be, and then it gives us a short list of things. But I think as far as when it says, even so, must their wives be, all of those things really apply to the women too, you know, in a sense. It's not going to be exactly the same, but we're still supposed to be all of those things that we just read about.
Mm-hmm.
And it says to be so, to be grave, not slanderers, sober, faithful in all things. When I was reading through this and kind of going through all this in my mind, the big thing that stood out to me, when we were talking, what do you think the main thing is that came up? And the ways that you could help or hinder it?
Your speech.
Yep, your tongue. Your lips, what comes out of your mouth. And I think as women, we have a tendency to have that be a weakness of ours, is letting our tongue say things it shouldn't say. And, you know, we can really hurt our men with our tongue, or we can help them and encourage them and uplift them. So I wanted to just read a couple of verses on that. Let's read Proverbs 14, verse 1. Every wise woman buildeth her house, but the foolish plucketh it down with her hands and her mouth. And then we have Ephesians 4. Proceed out of your mouth, but that which is good to the use of edifying, that it may minister grace unto the hearers. And grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby ye are sealed unto the day of redemption. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. And be kind one to another, tender hearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven you. And that gives us a lot of things that we can do and things that we should not do with our tongue, with our mouth. It even says that we can grieve the Holy Spirit with what we say and do. So I want to go through a few verses, and what I'm going to do to help save time is hand out verses. Like, I have you guys each look one up and read it. Let's start with have you take 1 Timothy 5:11 through 15. And then you want to take Proverbs 5, 3 through 6. And we'll do Proverbs 7:11. Proverbs 10:18. Proverbs 11:9. I'll pass you. Proverbs 18:6-8. And then can you remember to also do 13? I'm not sure. Mm-hmm. So 6-8 and then 13. And then Proverbs 26:20-28. Proverbs 27:15. And last is Psalm 64:3. So you guys get to read all the verses that are not following God's commandment in that area of our life. The people in the back will get the good verses. All right, go ahead, Emily.
So 1 Timothy 5:11-15. But the younger widow refused, for when they have begun to wax wanton against Christ, they will merit, having damnation because they have cast off the first faith, and with all have learned to be idle, wandering about from house to house, and not only idle, but tattlers also, and busybodies, speaking things which they ought not. I will therefore that the younger women marry, bearing children, guide the house, give none of occasion to the advisor to speak reproachfully, for some are already turned aside after sleep.
That gives a pretty good picture of an idle tongue with the tattlers and the busybodies and the speaking things that they ought not. Yeah, from Proverbs 5:3-6.
For the lips of a strange woman drop as a honeycomb, and her mouth is smoother than oil. But her end is bitter as wormwood, sharp as a two-edged sword. Her feet go down to hell, her steps take hold on hell. Lest thou shouldst ponder the path of life, her ways are moving full, but thou canst not know them.
So there we have a strange woman, not a good woman, whose mouth sounds good. Everything she says sounds good, but it has a poison to it. It's sharp as a two-edged sword, and bitter as wormwood. So that's definitely not something you want to be like. I said 7-Eleven, but you know me. It's kind of pulled out of context, but this is talking about the woman in Proverbs 7 is, again, an example of a woman you do not want to be like. And you read the whole chapter to get a good idea of things that you don't want to be like, but I pulled out the verse that was specifically about the way that she would speak. So you can just read 11.
She is loud and stubborn. Her feet abide not at her house.
You probably could have even just read the first part, being loud and stubborn. Those are both things that are temptations, being loud and stubborn.
The opposite of making quiet.
Yes.
I'm sure we have to read a little while.
Yep, very much the opposite. Okay.
Proverbs
10:18. Yes.
Okay. Proverbs 10:18. He that hideth hatred with lying lips, and he that uttereth a slander is a fool.
Mm-hmm. You can actually go ahead and read the next two if you want.
Okay. In the multitude of words there wanteth not sin, but he that refraineth his lips is wise. The tongue of the just is as choice silver, the heart of the wicked is little worth.
Okay.
Proverbs 11:9. An hypocrite with his mouth destroyeth his neighbor, but through knowledge shall the just be delivered.
You could replace your husband with your neighbor too, but it also shows that you can really hurt other people. Everybody with your mouth. Great. 18:6-8.
A fool's lips enter into contention, and his mouth calleth for strokes. A fool's mouth is his destruction, and his lips are the snare of his soul. The words of a talebearer are as wounds, and they go down into the innermost part of the belly.
Mm-hmm.
He that answereth a matter before he heareth it, it is folly and shame unto him.
That's a good description of a fool's mouth, and I think everyone knows that a fool is not somebody you want to be. So these are definitely things to avoid.
10:6-10:18.
Yes.
Where no wood is, there no fire goeth out. So where there is no table for talebearer, the strife ceases. As coals are to burn coals and lit to fire, so is a contentious man kindle strife. The words of the talebearer are as wounds, and they go down into the innermost parts of the belly. Burning lips and a wicked heart are like a pot.
meditate on and make sure those aren't describing you.
What was that reference?
That was Proverbs 26, verses 20 through 28.
Proverbs 27:15. A continual dropping in a very rainy day and a contentious holding on my heart.
Can you read the next verse too?
Whosoever hideth her hideth the wind, and the ointment of his right hand which be bright itself.
And like somebody was saying earlier about a contentious woman and corner of a rooftop. All of those verses, you read them and you just kind of get feeling yuck, who wants that? So we can read the rest of the verses that I'll hand out, because God usually doesn't tell us stop doing this and don't do this and just leave you with that. He usually gives you something to do instead. He says, let him that steal no more, but let him labor with his hands. So he doesn't just tell you don't do this, he says here's something you should do to help you replace that bad thing. So let's go, let's see, I'm going to start here and work around this way. We'll start with Proverbs 4:24. And then Proverbs 5:1-2. And then Proverbs 8:6-8. Proverbs 15:1-4. Do you mind if I give you a handful in that chapter?
I got a voice.
You don't have a voice, so I give you. Do you mind, Sandy, if I have a couple? Okay, Proverbs 15:1-4, and 7, and 23. You might want to write it down. Otherwise, I can tell you again when we get to you. Okay. Proverbs 21:22-24. 21:23-24. Yep, 21:23-24. Okay, sounds good. I don't know how to count, but. All right, and then Proverbs 31:26. Were you going to do that with her? Psalm 34:13. And then Mr. Cannon gives you out Psalm 141:3. Psalm 141:3.
Me?
Yep. And then, do you want one? No. Okay. We will do jump up to the twins. And I didn't look close enough to Rebecca. You want to start? Oh, there's one more. Grace. Grace, you want her?
She doesn't
have a five. You have no white either.
She doesn't have a
five. Oh, okay. That's fine. We'll do whoever's next can take Psalm 35:28. And Psalm 126. 2-3. 1 Peter 3:10-11. And then the last one, we have one more person, and I think the last one. Alright, I'll do the last one, which is Proverbs 18:21. Okay, you want to start with Proverbs 4:24?
Put away from thee a forward mouth and perverse lip, put far from thee.
6:3. Hear, for I will speak of excellent things. In the opening of my lips shall be right things. For my mouth shall speak truth, and wickedness is an abomination to my lips. All the words of my mouth are in righteousness. There is nothing forward or perverse in them.
Proverbs 15:1-4.
Okay, so a soft answer turns away wrath, but grievous words stir up anger. The tongue of the wise you acknowledge right, but the mouth of fools pour out foolishness. The eyes of the Lord are in every place, beholding the evil and the good. A wholesome tongue is a tree of life, but perverseness therein is a breach in the spirit.
And then 7.
The lips of the wise disperse knowledge, but the heart of the foolish doeth not so.
And 23.
A man hath joy by the answer of his mouth, and a word spoken in due season. How good is it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think of the Proverbs 31 woman, which I don't have, oh, I do have her in here at some point, but that reminds me of her with the lips of the wise dispersing knowledge. When we open our mouth, we should have good things to say that are edifying to others. And also to know when we should speak and when we should not is very important. All right, and then Proverbs 21:23-24.
Whoso keepeth his mouth and his tongue, keepeth his soul from troubles. Proud and haughty scorner is his name, who dealeth in proud wrath. It reminds me of the verse that I don't remember exactly what it is, in Romans 3 something. But anyway, the verse that says that every mouth may be stopped and all the world may become guilty before God. Every now and then when I think of saying something, I think, I better just shut my mouth. That reminds me of that verse. You know,
yes.
Like, well, shut my mouth.
A soft answer turneth away wrath, but grievous words stir up anger.
Okay, Proverbs 31:26. Okay, I can read that one. Proverbs 31:26. She openeth her mouth with wisdom, and in her tongue is the law of kindness. Back to Psalm 34:13.
Keep thy tongue from evil and thy lips from speaking guile.
In Psalm
141:3. Set a watch, O Lord, before my mouth. Keep the door of my lips. That's a good prayer.
Yes.
Say frequently through the day.
Yeah. Definitely, this is something that we need to call on the Lord and ask for help and not just think, oh, I can do that by myself. Because I think all of us have experienced that failure of not sticking with it. And Psalm 35:28.
And my tongue shall speak of thy righteousness and of thy praise all the day long. Mm-hmm.
It's another good thing to replace things with is praising the Lord. Rather than complaining. And when we dwell on things that he's done for us, we'll be more likely to be content and not focus so much on the things of the world, what we don't have. Alright, Psalm 126:2-3.
Then was our mouth filled with laughter, and our tongue with singing. Then shall they mind.
power of the tongue, and they that love it shall eat the fruit thereof. And the last, I think you had mentioned that verse, Caitlin. Last verse I wanted to turn to is Psalm 19:14. I think we should all strive to have this be the true prayer of our hearts. Let the word of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. And like we talked about earlier, letting him be our strength and relying on him and not our own strength to control our mouths. And meditation of our hearts.
Heavenly Father, we thank you that we could come together and encourage one another and have this time to build up one another as women. And help us to remember that most important of all is our holiness toward you. And as we work that out, we can love one another in a proper manner. And pray that we'll be able to be an encouragement to our husbands, our fathers, our children, and whoever we come in contact with. In your name we pray.